You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV. Television addict! Television addict!
Television addict! Hello, welcome. It's TV Guidance Counselor. I am Ken Reed, as always. I am your TV Guidance Counselor, and as it is Wednesday, although you may be listening to this on a different day, it is being released on a Wednesday, it's time for a brand new episode of the show. And today's guest is fantastic. I got to talk to Musetta Vander, who is very, very funny, incredibly nice, has done some amazing work, told me maybe my favorite story about working on a Charles Band set, which you will hear here. She was on Buffy the Vampire Slayer in a bunch of music videos, has a fantastic life story, grew up in South Africa, had not seen TV until her teens. I'll let her tell you in this episode because she tells it far better than I do, but it's a pretty fascinating story and I loved talking to her. She could not be nicer. Really think you will enjoy this episode quite a bit. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy today's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Musetta Vander.
TV is my friend and it has been always there for me.
Very well, thank you.
Did I get it close?
You
I
got
always, it. I'm with my Boston accent background, and you know, where we just have Irish and Italian people.
No, that was perfect.
Okay,
yeah, it's perfect.
My wife's from England, and she's always, if there's like some complicated Italian name, I always have no problem with it because I'm like, oh yeah, his name is Tagliatelle, and she's like, how do you? I'm like, well, because we had like eight of those in my school.
That is that's too the only funny. Thing.
And any Indian name she can do because those are like the complicated names where she grew up. So between the two of us, we can pronounce most names.
That's so funny. Yeah, mine is actually an abbreviation of my maiden name.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because it was so long when I first came here. It was like my first name being unusual, and then
right.
Van der Merwe. People were like looking at me like, what?
Yeah.
So I just decided to shorten it to Vander. It was just simpler.
Yeah. I think a lot of people probably do. Like yeah. Your own Ellis Island. Like they just shortened it when I came in and it stuck with me.
Yeah, exactly.
So to that point, you grew up in South Africa, right?
Yes, I did.
So how old were you when you came here?
I was about, well, the first time I came to the States, I was in university. I just came as a student traveling pretty much from like LA to New York, and I was absolutely blown away.
Right.
I was just, you can't imagine. I mean, it sounds crazy, but when you come from South Africa and not growing up with television, you land like at Disneyland on your first day.
Right.
It's like mind-blowing, even as an adult at that point, which I was probably about 18 or 19.
But still, like, the concept that that's a real place.
Yeah, I mean, I was, like, holding on to the characters and, like, playing with them like they were...
It's Cinderella! She's here!
We were like the tourists from hell.
Yeah.
I'm sure they
get it all the time.
Yeah. And then when I... everywhere we went was just amazing. I mean, next stop was Vegas, and then we ended up in New York, which was amazing, and I saw Blade Runner.
Yeah.
Okay, that was the first... I saw Queen at Madison Square Gardens, and I saw Blade Runner. And I was like, oh my God, America is amazing!
What an introduction!
I cried all the way home, and I knew one day I would come back. And then, you know, many years later, I made the transition. I moved here when I was about, I guess, 26... 25, 26.
And you've been modeling and stuff before that?
I was a professional dancer most of my life.
Okay.
My mother was a ballet teacher, so I was always in the entertainment business. But
right.
I, after, you know, I qualified as a ballet teacher, and then I went to university and I studied psychology and communications, and then I entered the field of dancing full time.
So that was your in to get over here?
That was my in to get over there, and then I became a host of a show while I was there, and that's why my husband saw me on TV, and that's how I ended up here.
Okay.
That's a long story.
Just, you know, that classic tale.
Well, it was just a very bizarre alignment of events where you
stuff
kind of
just
go,
lines up like that.
It does, you know. I mean, sometimes you can really try to change the direction of where you think your life should be going, but the universe will just push you in this direction and going, okay, your lessons are here.
This is where you're supposed to be.
You can do this the easy way or the hard way, but you're going to go this way first.
I mean, so many of the people that I know out here, they got here through these really like twist of fate things, and it ends up being your life is split into before this and after this, like that's the but it's so it's a small thing on the surface that ends up just completely changing the direction. And it sounds like that's the case there.
Yeah, this was like, the coincidences were like ridiculous that ended me in America, to the point that one day I actually stopped and I looked up at the heavens and I go, okay, I get it.
Yeah.
I'm supposed to go to the United States.
I'm picking up all the clues. You can stop
like
now.
Nonstop.
Being out here, have you been to like the Bradbury Building or any of the Blade Runner kind of sites?
Yes, the Bradbury Building for sure. We actually shot a movie there. My husband's very first movie. We shot down there in the Bradbury Building many, many, many years ago.
Did it hit you that was the building from Blade Runner when you were there? Did you know before?
Yeah, I did know. Okay. I was very excited because, you know, it was one of my favorite movies.
Yeah.
And everything about what happened was surreal because it was all like preempted in some way, and then suddenly I was in the middle of it all.
Yeah.
So it was very exciting.
And in the very kind of the first thing you saw in America, it's like going through the screen. You're like, I'm in the building.
I know, isn't it crazy?
Which I always get here, because Boston, although still America, it might as well be South Africa in many ways because it's so far away from here that I don't think I first came out here until I was about 30. And I was like, what was I thinking? It's all the things I like and everything's familiar, even if you've never been there. And it's kind of a very strange.
Yeah.
But to go back to South Africa, you said you didn't even have a TV when you were growing up.
No, I didn't. We didn't have a television. We didn't have any TV in South Africa till 1975.
So even if you had a TV, there was nothing to watch on it, basically.
No, there actually weren't any TVs.
You couldn't even get one.
There was no channels. There was no TV. I would listen to the radio. So I would listen to the radio late at night. I would sometimes rush home from school to listen to a radio program that was on like 3 o'clock, or at night I would listen to like squad cars, when I wasn't allowed to listen to. So I'd be like, have my radio under my pillow and listen to this episode of squad cars.
Which are like scripted television shows on radio, like old style radio.
Old style radio shows that have like episodics, and you tune in and like you'd run home to listen to the next episode.
Like Little Orphan Annie in 1931 or something. But was it BBC World Service stuff, or were they produced in South Africa?
They weren't produced in South Africa.
I wonder where they even came from.
Probably England, and I think some of them America. South Africa is very much modeled after America, but television, when television came along, my dad had bought a TV, and we were one of the first families in the neighborhood to have a TV, so it was like this big black thing in the living room, and every day we'd come in and I'd like look at the test pattern and have this counting down clock, and we were like, oh yeah, wonderful. Every day we'd come in and my friends would come in, we'd look at the TV, and then finally when South Africa announced live television, well, not live, but when the president airing stuff. The president came on, and I was like, oh, he's in our living room.
Yeah.
How did he get in there?
Oh, it's a total mind-blowing
thing. It's mind-blowing when you don't have that at all. I mean, we had drive-ins. I went to the drive-in theater.
Right. So you saw a lot of movies, but it's a totally different thing. And one of the things that I talk about with television here is that it's smaller than life in that it's more intimate. So it's coming into your home.
Yeah.
So it's with you. And a movie's an event. Like you go out, it's thing, you're with people, and it's like going to a restaurant versus cooking at home or something. There's something unique to the TV that people connect with because it's in their own environment.
Absolutely. You know, because when at that point I was only about 11 years old, and I couldn't go to the drive-ins whenever I wanted to. I couldn't drive. So watching that TV program, anything that came on, I was glued to. We only had TV for 2 hours a day.
Right.
Okay, so it was like the president would announce things, and then it'd be like the news, and it was the Brady Bunch. Okay, and I was like blown away I was like, oh my God, they're so happy. Look how happy these families are. Well, that's nothing like our life. I mean, I fight for my brother,
Oh, yeah.
The Brady Bunch, everybody's perfect, I mean, it was a different dynamic. It was like some surreal ideal family situation. We're going, wow, that's very different from how we live.
Yeah, I think it was different from a lot of people,
it was just like there was no reality based.
Have you ever driven by the Brady Bunch house out here?
No, I have not.
It's not far from here.
Really?
Yeah, it's in Studio City, and it's the same. And you go by it, and you're like, that's the Brady Bunch
house.
Are
you serious?
Yes.
I have to go check it out.
It's real. I'll give you the address. It's
really
good
to find
out.
I have
to
see that.
You may have even driven by it before and just not even noticed it. And it's such an iconic, weird thing. And again, probably the first American house you've seen on a television show. And it's just right there.
Oh, yeah. We saw that. We saw the CarolBurnett show. And I just was astonished at how happy everybody was.
Yeah, that seems pretty accurate. You
know,
yeah.
You know, so that was our 2 hours of TV. And I'm sure there were other programs that came in and out, but those are the ones I was always glued to.
It's interesting that that's what they exported, because normally they don't export comedies because they don't travel very well to other countries, even English speaking countries. They don't travel very well because comedy is such a cultural local thing.
Oh, I don't know. CarolBurnett, I think her comedy just transcends, you know, anything. I went at places. There were days when I would laugh so hard in the living room, like I would cry. She did some episode where she lost her contact lenses.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and she's on a date, and she ends up at the end of the episode. Everything goes wrong at the end of the episode. She fell out the window. Well, I was crying and laughing so hard and so long that I was on the floor. That my father came in to check on me to make sure.
Are you okay?
I was okay. I just love that really slapstick broad. That
Especially as a kid, that's exactly what's going to appeal to you.
Oh my gosh, yes. Yeah.
So were you drawn to comedy stuff generally? Like a lot of the stuff you've done hasn't really been that comedic, but.
No. When I started with the acting, I didn't really do acting in South Africa because when I was growing up, there weren't very many opportunities to do
that.
I was doing a lot of, obviously, dance and theater, right? But yes, there was no industry. And when I did start getting into the industry, when it finally opened, I did get in on the hosting side right away. But it was a different perception there. You had to go get a degree in acting and be like a thespian. And,
right.
You know, and...
you have to be trained to do this.
Yes.
We're not just going to let you be a doctor.
Yeah, it's like, I'm like, really? How many Shakespearean pieces of dialogue do we see on TV? But and my parents were like, no, we're not paying for you to be an actor. You got to go study and get a real degree.
Right.
You know, something you can fall back on one day. So, okay, whatever. But there was not one or the other that I liked. I did start with some TV shows down in South Africa. I mean, movies and stuff that I did. I just inadvertently started entering. And once you're in the entertainment business, it's like you segue into many different aspects of it.
And it's a small world.
It's a very small world. And I don't have a preference for one or the other. I do love comedy, but I love drama as well.
Yeah.
You know.
So what was the show you were hosting?
It was a show called Telemusic, which was like an MTV type show back in the day. And it was on like 6 o'clock in the evening for like a half an hour. And honestly, I mean, I would introduce the music videos.
Right.
Sometimes I wouldn't even have a chance to see them. You know, I wouldn't, you know, nobody, it wasn't like here where everything's organized and you could see the music videos. I would just introduce these music videos with these artists. Like, let's say Rod Stewart or whoever it was. And it was amazing because when I came here, I would suddenly now be in these music videos.
Yeah, I was going to say, you're in a Rod Stewart video.
Yeah. So that was like surreal because I would see what I had done or introduced after the fact.
Right.
You know, and go, oh, that's a really cool video. I wish I'd seen it a little bit earlier.
I could talk about it a little bit.
I could have done something maybe more interesting with it. But, you know, you're so naive. I was very young still. I think it was about, you know, I was a young 23, you know, I mean, you get 23 or 22, I can't remember the age I was in, but being here then and walking into the world of music videos inadvertently, you know, and suddenly there's Rod Stewart and he's, I'm talking to him, and there's Tina Turner and I'm talking to her, you know, it's a different world.
Yeah, I mean, it's, and especially where you had a connection to it on this other level too. It wasn't just totally jumping in where it made it weirder that you had been connected at all to it if you hadn't been in the first place, I think.
Well, that's that alignment of like cosmic alignment that happens, you know, where you just realize, wow, okay. Since I was a little girl, I remember sitting on the front porch when I was like, probably four or five, and I just knew one day I would not live in this country. I just intuitively knew I would live either out of the country, maybe America or Australia or England.
Having never traveled to those places.
Having never traveled.
And had your family been in South Africa a while? Like they were like,
this
is where we live. This is, people don't leave, you're here.
No, I'd never traveled out of the country ever. My first trip was to America.
And no one else in your family was into performing?
My mother was a ballet teacher.
Okay. Oh, you said that. Yes, she was a ballet teacher.
She was a very successful ballet teacher and also opera singer.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it's in the family a little bit, but still in a localized area.
Yeah, she did. My family did travel a lot, but, you know, as a kid, of course, I didn't. But, you know, the minute I always want, I love traveling. I can't get enough of it.
I mean, some people, I think you just know that you're, even if you don't dislike the place where you are when you're a kid, or you may as a kid and then kind of look back more fondly on it as an adult, you kind of just know that it's not where you're supposed to be.
Yeah,
you might not know where that is, but you kind of just know it doesn't quite fit.
Yeah, no, I loved South Africa. I mean, it's a beautiful country, but in my gut, I just knew. I had a book, a little book, you know, and when I was a kid, and it was different careers girls can do when they grow up. And I paged through all of these, and I was like, nah. And then I saw an actress, and like a guy with a boom mic holding over, and the cameras around her, and I go, that's what I'm going to do.
Yeah.
I just knew.
Well, it's probably the most appealing, too. And it's really put it in a very specific, like, here's women's jobs. Yeah. Yeah. Like, secretary, nurse, teacher. But out of those two, and it's like, oh, actress seems like the pretty much the exciting
and
one here.
Yeah, and fun and exciting, you know. And I mean, being born in that business, there was absolutely no other option for me, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not going to be doing well in an office.
Were you getting recognized? I mean, obviously your husband recognized you, but were you getting recognized in South Africa for hosting that show? Like how?
No, maybe if people really followed the show.
Right. Most people probably still didn't have TVs, right?
No, at that point, but when I hosted the show, that was already South Africa. Well, that was 11, 1975. So when I hosted the show, it was probably 1984, 85 in that area. So yeah, people definitely had television shows. But, you know, it was still limited. There was only two or three channels of television, you know, and if you weren't a music fan, you probably wouldn't watch that. And I don't know, you know, it wasn't like today where there's media. You can access anybody everywhere.
Right.
You know what they look like. You know, it's like...
In seconds. Like
instantly. Yeah. You can find out anything about a person. So some people who wouldn't like music shows, yes, they know who I was.
Were they government channels like BBC?
This was the SABC.
Okay, so
South African Broadcasting Corporation.
So they have two channels, like one.
They had
and two
channels, channel one and two, and then they had like I think two African channels, which were with different African languages.
Okay.
Yeah. So, but they mainly had the two channels at that time.
And it was a lot of content from other countries, or were they producing a lot of stuff? Like what?
They did. I danced in quite a few shows that was locally produced.
Okay.
You know, like award shows or ceremonies or whatever. You know, sometimes I do TV shows where, ironically, I would be on the set like of where I would be as a dancer. With some big production period piece, and I'd look at all the actors, you know, and I'd be dressed like the actors, but I'm a dancer, and I'd be like, okay, I'm on the wrong side. I need to be over there.
Yeah, we should be speaking about
Yeah, because the dancers, you work so hard.
Yeah.
You work so many hours, and you get a fraction of what the actors get. And
to make them look good.
Yeah, and you stand in the back, and you're like going, here, present.
Yeah.
And I was like, no, not like enough now of that. I need to go the other way.
I'd like to be more than a supplemental background thing for making the whole thing look
good.
Well,
it's like in my core, right? Yeah. I love being an actor. I just love the expression and freedom it gives you. It's like being a sponge to absorb all these different people and characters and emotions and then to reflect them back.
Are you an only child or do you have siblings?
No, I have siblings.
Okay, are you youngest, oldest?
I'm the oldest.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, so were you... Like, you know, if your parents are having a party, they're like, give me something to have her do her dance or like do that impression you do. Are you that kind of kid or are you more like the...
Well, when I was young and when I was the only child, yes, that would happen quite a bit.
Yeah.
Because my mother was very, very, very good ballet teacher. And I, for my age at that time,
you're a little
protégé. Yeah, I was really well trained. So, which that training really translated well when I finally got here because I would walk into all these auditions and if I needed to do any movement, you know, I was really a strong dancer.
Right. It's a discipline probably most people don't have here.
Yeah, I was very disciplined. Everything in my life, my schooling, the schools I went to, it was like super disciplined. Your nails were an inch, not even an inch, a few millimeters over. They put your hands up like that. If the nails were over, you cut them. If your shoes weren't polished, you have to polish your shoes. Your dress could only be 4 fingers above your knee. Jeez. I mean, it was strict. Your hair could never touch your collar. It had to be tied back. I mean, it was like strict. You know, so I came from strict discipline and I was used to that. So ballet is a very strict discipline to be able to dance like that.
And precise.
And, you know, you can't do anything if you don't practice. So I was used to putting in the hours and willing to do that.
But it's probably exciting to get to be all different kinds of characters and break out of that as well, but still have the skill you took from that to be able to do it in a precise way. But now you're sort of controlling it, which is
absolutely
good.
You know, absolutely. I think that... the thing about being an actor, I think you still have a part of it, which is you are portraying somebody else's vision of it. It's not your dialogue. It's not what you would be saying, but you have to portray whatever the other person has written and portray the way they perceive it. And that's a wonderful part of it. But there's another part where you are on a stage, for example, we have a live feed from the audience.
Right, so you can make adjustments.
Yeah, it's wonderful. And it's a energy which you miss when you're on camera.
Right.
But the rewards are great.
Yeah, it travels side. More, but at the same time, it's not, the yeah. immediate response. You know, it's always like there's that famous, they call, what is it, the three stool legs of production, where it's like you can have it good quality, fast, cheap. You can only have two of those three things at any time. So, you know, if it's good quality and fast, it's going to be expensive.
Right.
If it's fast and it's cheap, it's not going to be great.
Right.
And it's almost like that. Like if you get the immediate response, it's going to be for a smaller group of people or, you know,
yeah.
if it's, so it's a sort of a compromise, especially then. I mean, now the world's a little bit different now
yeah.
where you can have things that are global all at once,
yeah.
but it must've been a little strange. And so you're feeling, you're in South Africa, you're getting some of these American shows, Brady Bunch and CarolBurnett, which is fascinating to me that that's what we're sending out to,
yeah.
to the rest of the world as sort of the ambassador to America and probably the first kind of American things you've even seen.
Yeah, we had Kojak as well. I remember Kojak was one of the shows we had. But those two really stood out to
yeah.
me because they were the first ones I kind of saw.
Yeah, and I found that all my friends that grew up in countries outside the U.S., they like Kojak makes sense because
right.
that travels. You know,
right.
it's a cop show, it's
right.
a drama, action, like right. regardless of background or cultural stuff, everybody kind of gets that.
Right.
The Brady Bunch, where it's like a mixed marriage and, you know, very 70s cultural stuff, that's like, I imagine people are like, what alien planet has this come from? I mean, we even thought that in Boston sometimes, but pretty much it was so strange.
Well, it's so funny because as a child, you just never questioned it.
Yeah, this is just the thing.
I just never even thought about it. I just was like, wow, they so many kids and they're all perfect. And they're so well behaved. It's just like, wow, that's
right.
wild.
It's something to aspire to. So, but that sort of thing in the movies you saw as well would set up your perceptions for what America was like, I imagine, for when you did get here.
Yeah, I definitely think that. You know, it wasn't a big adjustment for me to come to America. Yeah, it was obviously thousands of times larger and
right.
more challenging in many ways. But we spoke the same language.
Yeah.
You know, I was in the same business. It was much more thrilling for me because I remember one of my first auditions was at like the Debbie Reynolds dance studio.
Right.
And there were thousands of dancers. I don't remember my number. I was like number, I don't know, 700 or something. And it was just to be there and to audition and that level. I
yeah.
loved it.
Yeah. It's a
yeah.
whole different world. It's,
yeah.
it's surreal. Like you're like,
yeah.
I can't believe it's a real thing.
No, I loved it. Every
yeah.
time I get a job, I'd be like, wow, it's amazing.
Yeah.
It's like when I fly back home from South Africa and I'm flying like over LA and it's like, you know, that hour descent into LA, 30
oh, yeah.
minutes, you're still flying over LA. And I go, wow, every time I get a job, I look at all these people and go, how
me.
Fortunate I am.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know how fortunate you are.
It's like kind of despite everything
yeah.
that you're able to get these kinds
that you
of
can get,
things.
That you can work.
Yeah.
And do what you love.
Which is, that really is the dream. It's not the American dream. That's just a dream of everybody.
Yeah.
And especially traveling so far to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So you move out here
mm-hmm.
full time. Were your parents still kind of like, maybe you want to
no.
do this for a year or something?
No. I was a very... rebellious teenager, for lack of a better word, probably
okay.
because I was so growing
yeah,
up so
I was gonna
strict.
Say, yeah.
When you have that many rules on somebody, you know you go break every single
yeah,
rule.
Yeah. You need that equilibrium.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
yeah. So I was like, you couldn't tell me what I was going to or not going to do because
right.
I was going to follow whatever I wanted to follow, which is probably I feel sorry if I look back now and think how my parents coped with me.
Right.
You know, I was just like, no, I'm not. I'm going.
But it worked out.
Yeah. So I never questioned it.
Right.
I absolutely never questioned it was like eating breakfast.
Yeah, you have to do it.
It was the next step.
Right. And was there a gig that you got when they were finally like, okay, you're doing it. Like it's a thing now. Like you've convinced us. Like we're impressed.
Well, you know, it's funny because at that point for me to be able to show my parents the work I was doing here, I had to try and get, in those days it was beta SB tapes
yeah.
and all of those things. And then I had to get it into a format
convert
that I can
PAL.
Actually convert it to them and
yeah.
then send it to them. And
yeah.
so that hopefully they can see it on their system. And, you know, I don't think they really started understanding what I was doing. Of course, with the dance, yes. And with the music videos, yes. They,
yeah.
Because I would try to send it, but it would take weeks to get there.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
And yeah, I think they were very proud of me, even though they didn't really understand the level of competition that
right.
you have here. You know, it was just, well, I always kind of worked.
Yeah,
you know?
Their sphere of reference is so much smaller. But at the same
yeah.
time, probably like, she's making a living, she's not
yeah.
starving,
yeah.
she seems happy.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah, and I was very well prepared. You know, I think at that point, any parent would have to sit back and just say, well, we gave her the best education we could. We trained her and everything.
Yeah.
She's on her own now. You've got your own free will, and you have to follow that. I think when you divert from that, you just delay the inevitable.
Right, right, and make it harder when you do have to go in.
Much harder.
So what was the first thing that you booked here? Was it a music video?
My very first job I think I ever booked here was a dance show.
Okay.
That I was dancing. I was at the Demi Reynolds Dance Studio. It was for a singer from Australia, I believe he was. And it was they were looking for four girls. And I actually booked the job with another actress who I'm still very friendly with today, who's a big star now.
Yeah.
And I guess you wouldn't mind if I mentioned her name. It's AndieParker.
Oh, wow. Yeah,
yeah. So AndieParker and I and two other girls booked this job. And my first job was in Hawaii.
Not bad.
Yeah. And I had a hotel room, well, like my own apartment on the beach in Waikiki. And literally we would go in and we'd dance at the Hilton for like an hour and a half at night.
So it's a live show that he's
doing. Was a live show that tourists would come to see him sing.
Yeah.
You know, and the trip went all over the place. But that was the base in Waikiki at the Hilton Hawaiian Village. And at night, we would be on the beach all day long, and at about 6 o'clock, I'd brush off the sand, you know,
do the go dancing,
put my makeup on and get into my outfit and do the cowboy dance I had to do, or whatever dance number I had to do. And it was bliss.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's going to set the bar pretty high. You're like, man, jobs are great. You go to Hawaii.
Yeah, I mean, it never dawned on me that jobs were hard to get. And I just never thought of it as hard.
Yeah, I mean, you. I think to a degree, some of it is a little bit of luck, and a lot of people like, I got lucky and whatever. But at the same time, I always say that, yes, you may have gotten lucky in getting to the right place, but if you can't deliver what you need to deliver when you get there, you're not going to get the thing.
I think that is key. To get the opportunity to audition is the hardest part.
Yeah.
Once you get in that room, if you have your goods and you can deliver the performance as best you can, and you turn around, you walk out, there's nothing more you can do at that point.
Right.
You know, you can only go, okay, it's up to the universe. And, you know, there's going to be 10 people making a decision on
right.
you.
The if one it's might, right, it's
one,
right.
One wants a blonde, another one wants blue eyes, other one wants, I don't know.
Yeah, and it's always something outside your hands. Like, the director thought you looked too much like a girl he did in high school and it made him uncomfortable. Like, it's always some weird thing you can't even control.
So I just let it go at that point. You just have to let it go. But, you know, I think when you're younger, especially as an actor in the entertainment business, when you're in your 20s and your 30s, it's very easy to get auditions because that's kind of the up-and-coming market.
Yeah.
When you get older, it's a whole different dynamic to get the audition, to get the opportunity. Once you're in that room, there's a very good chance you can get the job.
Right. But there's fewer jobs, too.
There's fewer jobs.
And they're very specific types, sort of. I feel like for the cattle call type stuff, they'll be like, it's a young ingenue. And be like, what you like? I don't know. Show me some people, and when we see her, it's right.
Yeah.
But now they'll be like, look, you're a police detective. We have a thing in mind. And it's a little more specific.
Also, people have formed opinions about who they think you are.
Because they've seen your work already.
They've seen your work. Yeah. And they might have seen you and this and then think, oh, but you can't play that. But, you know,
you can only do this kind of role.
It's ludicrous in my brain, and that people would think that and label things and compartmentalize things.
Which is the exact opposite of an actor. Like, the actor is, you can do all these things, and they're like, no, you can only do this one thing.
Of course.
It's very strange.
Yeah.
So you get this live show, and then you're just going for auditions for videos and happen to book
some? No, that was in Hawaii, so I stayed in Hawaii for 6 weeks. And then I came back, and then I got an agent, and I did a play at first.
Okay.
I did a play called Soweto's Burning, about an interracial relationship during the height of apartheid South Africa.
Yeah, with full-on acting role with lines and everything.
That's huge.
Yeah,
we put the play on ourselves, and it was at the Hudson backstage.
Okay,
actually, we were the first play ever in there. We built pretty much the interior of that stage, and the seats that are in there today, we got from a theater that had closed and put in there. And that's the Hudson.
It's very industrious. You're like, we got to do this.
Yeah, my husband and I put that up together, and that was where we worked. And then I had, of course, on the side, I had. From that, I got my agent.
Mm-hmm.
My agent came to see me. I got an agent and managers and everything like that. And then I started going out. But before that, I was really going out in the dance world. The first thing I got was a dance agent.
Right.
And they started sending me out in the commercials. But the music video was the entrance. And then once I put that play on, I brought in the agency. And then I stepped into... And also, I trained here.
Right.
I trained for like the first 2 years. Because I feel you do need to kind of... You know, have a...
You have to acclimate.
I think you have to have a solid training. But one thing that happened to me, which was, I was in this class. I'm not going to mention the class, but...
Fair enough.
It was like a very strict class.
Right.
And I'd gone out on an audition for something that was at the IFC, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
And when I first came and I registered myself with SAG, they had all these categories. I didn't know what they meant, right? So I saw Caucasian. I go, well, I don't know what that is. I saw Asian. I go, well, I know I'm not that.
Right.
I saw Hispanic. I go, well, I don't really know what that is. And then I saw African American. I thought, oh, perfect.
Yeah. Well, you're African American.
I'm African American. Yeah. I check African American.
Yeah.
So I get the audition, right?
Oh, that must have been.
And I walk into the room and everybody's like,
how dare you?
Staring at me like, you're white.
Yeah.
And I'm like, yeah. They go, but SAG has you listed as African American. I go, yeah, but I am.
Yeah.
They go, what do you mean? I go, well, I'm from Africa and now I live in America.
Yeah, I mean that makes sense.
Yeah. So anyway, so it was a short film and the director really liked me and it was actually for an African American character.
Right.
And so he changed it and I became he hired me for the role.
Right. Right.
However, the acting class I was in was very, very strict.
Oh, yeah.
And would not allow you. The teacher would sound like, you, nobody can go out and act before you have training. It's like trying to be a doctor and do surgery before you understand
how to
do surgery.
Yeah.
But I'd already booked the job.
Yeah.
So I was so...
You're not going to turn a job down.
I turned the job down.
Did you?
Yes, and the short film won an Academy Award.
Oh, dear.
Yes.
Yes. That's a lesson learned.
That I will never do again.
Yeah.
And I recommend it. Anybody hearing this, if anybody tells you can't go out and audition for anybody, don't listen.
It's easier to get another acting class than to get another role in a short film.
Yeah, and that just comes back to that mindset where you feel, well, you're probably right. Maybe I'm not good enough.
Yeah.
But I'd already gotten the drive.
Yeah, but that's a drive. I think people who are driven to being in the arts and any sort of self-expression thing, there is that insecurity and that oversensitivity, which gives you the ability to kind of be able to do these things. And that voice that's like, maybe you're not that great, which makes you work towards something.
Right. Well, this teacher never even knew I had booked the job.
Right.
I was too afraid to even tell her.
You didn't want to,
even tell her.
Well, if you grew up going to very strict schools anyway, you kind of had that mentality like, you can't not do, I couldn't be like, I didn't do my homework, I was sick. They don't care.
It's a different mentality. But that was a very bitter pill to swallow. When I look back on that, I was like, I should never have done that because I could have easily, it wasn't easy for me. Obviously, I booked it already.
Yeah, yeah. But it's an important lesson you had to learn too because, and it's kind of good that, although clearly not a fun experience, it was good that you learned it early rather than later in the career when it could have really done some major damage to what you were trying to do, which is interesting.
Yeah.
The other thing is, it reminded me, I used to work at a place with a bunch of guys from Jamaica.
Right.
And someone, I just worked there and I didn't know anyone's name yet. And one of the guys came looking for this woman and I was like, oh, someone came looking for her. She goes, who was it? I was like, oh, it's the Jamaican guy. She goes, he's African American. And I'm like, he's from Jamaica. Like, he's not. He's Jamaican. Like, he's Jamaican.
Right.
But there's like a real, here especially, there's a real...
Right.
You know, I'm like, it's not. It was very, very odd. So that does not surprise me, but it's fantastic.
And this is hilarious. So obviously, I had to go and back to SAG and change my label to Caucasian.
I'm no longer African American.
They were very confused.
Yeah.
What do you mean? I'm like, well,
apparently
I'm Caucasian.
There was some stuff going on. It's all sorted out now. It's fine.
Because South Africa had white, black, colored, right?
Yeah.
It's simple. Okay, well, you fall into white, or you fall into black, or you fall into colored.
Yeah.
Those were the categories at that time.
Did you hit up against, not to get heavy, but did you hit up against, because you said you were doing the play about apartheid.
Yes.
Did you get really, I mean, I assume they lumped everybody in the same bucket of like, if you're from there, you must have been.
Oh, yes. Yeah. It was very difficult being from South Africa during that time. You know, people immediately labeled you as, especially being white and Afrikaans, as some racist person. And like I had made the laws in the country and, you know, responsible for things. Yeah, it was hard. It would definitely affect my interviews, my job, my ability to audition for things, or people's opinions of me. It doesn't matter what you do. You know, people form opinions on you just...
On what's on the paper,
On what's in the paper. It's like if you look at the current climate, political climate, people coming from certain countries into this country right now immediately have a label on them, and you just kind of want to go, I don't want to deal with that.
Yeah. And you're also like, but these are the people that left that country.
Right.
You know, like you're just like, I'm not there anymore.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. But, you know, it's like, then it became what is politically correct.
Right.
instead of who's best for the job.
Yeah, which makes no sense at all. It's about the person, not about, you know, especially America. And I've, you know, when I lived in England, I found a little bit of this too, where America's so huge that I started doing stand-up there, and it was right when the Iraq War broke out.
Right.
And they wouldn't introduce me as American. They couldn't. I would get booed off the stage. They had to say I was from Canada. And I'm like, look, Boston's not Texas. Like, it's not, it's a huge country. People have a wide variety of thoughts, but it's very much like that's the whole country.
Well, you know, that it's like we get spoon-fed on what to think.
Right.
You know, and heaven forbid you break the mold.
Yeah. You know, people don't know how to handle it.
You get labeled very quickly as this or that, or they try to squash you.
Right. Because especially at that time, I remember the guy in Bruce Springsteen's band had that big anti-apartheid Sun City record that came out.
Sun City.
Yeah, and there was the whole, there was a few movies that were shot there. Dolph Lundgren did a movie called Red Scorpion there.
Yeah, I remember
'88, which probably was a huge American production coming there.
Yeah.
And then Cannon started shooting movies there. They did Alienfrom L.A. with Kathy Ireland. Yeah,
my husband actually worked on Alien.
Oh, really?
LA. Yeah, and there were a lot of Cannon movies. Yeah. There were a lot of movies, period, back in the day.
Oh, Albert Pinn did a bunch there.
That's right.
Yep. And
Journey to the Center of the Earth. Yep.
And what's the one with
American Ninja 2.
American Ninja 2. Sharon Stone, that was in
Romancing the Stone.
Oh, King Solomon's Mines. Alan Quarterman and the all those ones, yeah.
Right.
They were shooting a lot, like early, mid, late 80s all of a sudden.
A lot.
Yeah.
There was a lot. There was really a lot, and that was another thing that was so weird, because, you know, I'd be there and, you know, my husband would work on the movie, or I'd be working on something down there. And then you have to come back here. You're not allowed to say where the movie was shot.
Right.
You have to avoid it in conversation.
Right.
Completely. Like, oh, yeah, I shot it in Burbank.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know where it was. they blindfolded me. I show up on the set. I don't know.
So you have to pretend you're naive and you don't know, you know.
Yeah.
So I think you get into that thing where you're like, oh no, I had no idea. But you know, of course you know it.
You have to do acting when you're not in a thing.
Pretty much. You have to pretend you don't know.
Yeah. So that it's almost like leading a weird double life almost
you're trying to
show that you've worked on these things that are, you know, and again, it has nothing to do with you.
No.
The political climate has nothing to do with you. You're a working actor. It's a movie that's, you know, it's helping the economy in a lot of ways. And it's an opportunity to work with, you know, like Dolph Lundgren. And he's a big star, you know. And it's something you can't wear as a badge of honor. It has to be something you're almost like ashamed of.
It was a very weird, you know, I mean, growing up under apartheid was first of all a weird thing. And then coming here and having to deal with, okay, now I can't say certain things, and I can't say I did a movie there, or I can't mention that this movie was shot there, because then this producer is going to get, I don't know, blacklisted, or, you know, it's like this,
it's going to be this huge domino.
Yeah.
Weird. It's
bizarre.
It's like being an embedded Soviet spy or something.
Well, it's like at the points I thought, well, maybe it's just best if I say I'm not from South Africa, but I had a very heavy accent at that time.
Right.
You know, there wasn't like accent coaching, and I didn't have hours of TV I sat and watched. I mean, it just happened that I ended up here. So once they perceive you,
you're done.
Accent,
you have one chance.
Even if you go in and you do a completely perfect other accent or American accent, they will sit and they will watch your lips literally, like, to see if they can hear. Oh, yeah, I heard a word.
They're kind of looking for you to fail.
Yeah, but if somebody doesn't know you, then you have the chance to actually go in there and just from scratch, clean slate.
How hard was that with the accent piece?
Well, what happened is when I first came here, obviously I was South African, so nobody had...
They didn't know the accent. Australian, I'm guessing, British.
And also they didn't know what to do with me, because I was not in sort of in this political no man's land.
Right.
And I had a South African accent. Yes, a lot of people felt it was more Australian, but it's not really typical Australian. So obviously I got pushed into sci-fi world.
Right.
Because in the sci-fi world, I can be anything.
Right. You're from this planet, and that's
how
they talk.
I'm from another planet. I can be anything. So that's how I ended up in the sci-fi world.
Yeah.
It was just my auditions generated that way.
Right.
You know, because I couldn't do at that time the American accent perfectly. I couldn't walk in and play a cop. And I didn't look like the American girl next door, because it was a specific type at that time.
Oh, yeah, certainly.
You know? Yeah. And I did not fit that mold.
Right. But in sci-fi, it's almost an asset. It's
and
like a special effects they don't have to do. Yeah.
So in sci-fi, I was doing great. I was having a lot of fun in sci-fi worlds, but I was longing to play like a normal drama.
Right.
You know, a comedy.
But then there's that weird double standard, too, that, you know, men at that time could have whatever accent they wanted. Arnold Schwarzenegger is playing cop John Smith from Chicago with no explanation of why he has a heavy Austrian accent. And everyone's cool with it.
It was a very different time, I think, for female actors than it is today.
Yeah.
Very different.
You know, Jean-Claude Van Damme is a guy who grew up in Brooklyn. Everyone's like, sure, no problem.
Yeah, was sold on pre-sales.
Yeah,
you know,
we sold it based on the poster.
They did.
That's what they want.
They sold movies based on the poster.
And yeah,
it's still kind of in some ways like that, depending on who's attached to the scripts.
But, right.
But it was a very different time for female actors.
So you're getting the videos, and the first video I remember seeing you in, and it's quite a mix of videos too. And I'm a huge ChrisIsaak fan, and did a ChrisIsaak video, which is a really fun video, where it's like all 60s kind of go-go girl.
Yeah.
But having not grown up with that stuff, was that you're not getting the reference or the illusion?
No, I definitely grew up with 60s and 70s in that whole fashion. We had the same fashions during those times. And also, because I was a dancer, if for anything I had to do, my body could adjust to whatever. If I had to play a creature, it could be a creature. If I had to play, I don't know, uptight, you know.
You have that physical control.
I have the ability to change my body. That's the first part. You have to get the physical structure right. If I have to play praying mantis, or if I have to play a alien from another planet.
Right.
So the body language is the first thing that changes, and then everything else goes with it.
Were you familiar with a lot of the art? I mean, obviously Rod Stewart, you know, you're introducing the videos.
Yes.
But then you're in like an Amy Grant video, on Alice Cooper, who I imagine probably didn't make it down to South Africa.
No, if he did, I wasn't aware of it.
Yeah. And ChrisIsaak, who is just, I mean, I'm sort of fascinated by ChrisIsaak, because he's just this like amazing charm. Like, some of the best live shows I've ever seen in my life have been ChrisIsaak shows.
That was an amazing experience. All of them were amazing experiences. I mean, interestingly enough, the Tina Turner video that I did, because we were all multiracial couples, never aired on MTV during that time. It only aired in Europe. And I think to this day, I don't know, now you can find it on YouTube.
But that's a crazy thing for people to understand.
But isn't that crazy?
Yeah. I mean, when Bowie died recently, a lot of people were circulating this clip from MTV, which I don't know if you saw.
No.
But he goes on MTV in 83 or 84 and calls him out for not showing black artists.
Isn't that crazy?
And he's like, why aren't you showing what people are really listening to? There's all these acts and they're making, and it's, you know, it's America, MTV, mid-80s, where everyone's like, there's no, and the host is like, it's not me, you know, and it's amazing that, a video, you know, what, 86, 87, 88, somewhere around there, they're still like, oh, we can't air that.
Jaimin Hansu was my partner in that video. Shaving his head in the bathtub, and today he's like this mega star.
Yeah, I'm like, oh, we still can't air this. It's very, very strange.
Yeah, and it's crazy.
Especially when you're coming from a world when people are judging you for that stuff. Anyway, when that's going on.
Yeah, it was it was such a confusing world for me to be in. I was like, I don't understand.
Well, you are kind of an alien in that respect, too.
Yeah, like, so, you know, you just have to kind of go with the flow and just adjust. I mean, in anything in life, you have to adjust. But when I did the ChrisIsaak video, by that time, of course, I'd been here a while.
Yeah.
I knew the music. I knew exactly who ChrisIsaak was.
Yeah.
So,
this is post-Wicked Game. It was probably 94, 95.
Oh, it was amazing. Yeah. And so he's an artist as well. So he was tattooing all of us. We were three girls. I can't remember. But I remember he had my leg up, and he was tattooing some tattoo on my ankle and with a pen or marker he had. And I remember sitting there going, oh, I can just imagine my friends back home if they could see this now.
This is like a contest. They
were sitting there going, oh, my God, ChrisIsaak's tattooing my ankle.
To this day, many people would still probably enter that contest if you could do it.
Yeah, it was just a surreal experience.
So did people start to recognize you from videos at all here? Because you really realize how the penetration of America that these videos would get.
Yeah, people would say, oh, you look so familiar to me. You
know, we go to high school together?
Yeah, because at that stage, music videos were very prominent.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like today, it's like there's so many channels, but that was like MTV's heyday.
And that's when a lot of directors got their start.
That's
like you ended up working in
Michael Bay.
And these up and coming, very visual directors.
Yeah.
And it's like shooting a low budget movie. You know, a couple days to shoot this thing that looks huge.
Yeah.
And then you kind of transitioned into, and we were talking earlier, the other first sort of speaking role I remember seeing you in was Oblivion,
yeah.
Which was I think you shot part one and two at the same time.
I did.
It was like a space western.
Yeah.
But you're like just, you're the villain in the movie, basically, as this like Black Widow.
Yeah. Lash.
Like a whip. Yeah. 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 Lash. That's what it is.
Well, it was very funny because when I got that movie, it was great because Lash had to have a whip.
Right.
And I had to have whip training. So I had when Michelle Pfeiffer did Catwoman, she, yep. You know, she had that whip. So I had the same whip trainer. So I'd be like in my neighborhood in the park somewhere practicing how to wrap a whip around my body, how to crack a whip. I mean, people would just drive by and go like, what?
But I remember even here, there were people who were like, you could see any crazy thing out here and be like, right. It's for a movie.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. It was just such a wonderful time. But that movie was one of the first movies into Romania after the fall of Ceausescu.
Yeah.
It was a very interesting time to be in Romania because literally you could see like where bullet holes were in the walls. We stayed in this hotel at that point where there was literally nothing to eat. Okay, the beds, I think, had been there like forever. And
yeah,
the curtains
yeah.
were like smoky. And
because for people, just to put it in context, at one point, Romania was one of the great cities of, you know, they had one
of the
great cities
of the world. It was known as the Paris of the East.
Yeah, and so there's this amazing art deco.
Amazing architecture.
Beautiful gothic architecture that had just been completely decimated or just hollowed out from these years of conflict.
Yeah, I mean, they had literally rebuilt built a Champs-Élysées-like street in Romania that went up to their main parliament building.
Yeah.
And the people who had lived there, they were literally given like the day before, like, we're coming in tomorrow to destroy your house, take your stuff and leave.
Ugh.
And all these buildings was constructed and like abandoned. So people who used to live there might live like up at the top of the third floor, you'd see a little fire going, but there were no walls or anything, just sitting in the concrete trying
Jeez.
To like, it was crazy. You couldn't get milk. You know,
the phone only works an hour a day.
In the hotel, they put, you know how they put the videos in downstairs?
Yeah.
Well, that was really funny to see because they put the video in at the bottom of the hotel and then come up in your hotel room. And then you'd be watching the movie and going, well, it's kind of grainy quality. And then suddenly you see a guy standing up and walking
They're
across.
They're just filming a video
They
camera.
Were filming a video somewhere
showing
in the
you
theater.
Bootlegs.
And then in the middle of the bootleg, and they'll pull another one out and they'll go like, oh, and you're busy halfway watching something. And they'll just pull it out at the bottom, put a new one in.
Someone else wanted to watch something who had a little more money than you did or something.
Yeah. So we would go come home and then we're like, oh, I'm starving. I go, what are you gonna eat? I go, okay, I'll have chicken.
Yeah.
No, no chicken. Yeah. Okay, beef? No beef. Vegetables? Potatoes.
Oh, perfect.
Okay, perfect. I'll have potatoes.
We call it the chicken of Romania.
Yeah, yeah. So I mean, it was like a forced diet. I was very swelt at that time.
But a place that you probably would never have gone otherwise.
Oh my God!
And
yes.
You get to experience them. So
amazing people.
Yeah,
met amazing people, made amazing friends,
and some great sort of crew people there too who had worked on things, you know, for years before that. So that was Charles Band who ran Full Moon Studios, who had a deal with Paramount, had bought this.
Yes.
Castle or something in Romania.
Yes. Well, that lot that we built that entire set on was kind of close, I guess, to an airport, if I'm not mistaken. But it's the same lot that they used, or studios that they used later to shoot Cold Mountain at.
Okay.
We were the first one in there.
Yeah. He basically was like, I can get this huge thing for nothing.
But, you know, there they had so many dogs, right? So there was no animal kind of control ever. So dogs were everywhere,
just
on the
wild
streets.
Dogs,
just dogs and packs. So you'd be in the middle of shooting a scene, like, you know, the bar saloon scene where the cowboy comes
in
and walks in, and then in the middle of the shop, a shot a dog was just like running.
Dogs, we gotta
shop.
Stop, man. So Peter David wrote those who worked on like Heroes and stuff, and was a comic book writer, mm-hmm. wrote The Hulk Forever, which is one of the reasons I was very excited about that film series. And it was cowboys and aliens,
yeah,
basically
fantastic.
And you really got to be a big character. It was very comic booky in the best way.
Yes,
so
absolutely.
I imagine that was probably really fun to kind of just let loose.
Loved it. I loved it. There's a really funny story from that. We had to shoot the scene in the movie where I ride up on horseback and I'm with the other character, Bork, and he's on a mule and I'm on my horse and we're galloping up and I'm looking out over this vast plain and I look and there's where the draconium is and I go, the mother load. Except the day that we were supposed to shoot the scene, nobody told the horse wranglers that we needed horses. Okay, so there was no horses. It was our last day at this location. There was no horse. The mule was there, but the horse was not there. Okay, so the director frantically looks around.
Can we find a big dog?
Maybe? No, he found a grip, a big burly grip guy. And I looked at him, and he looked at the grip, and I go, no. And he goes, yes. And he goes, we have to do it. We
get
need
a saddle on him.
So they put me on his shoulders, okay? And I was in this really, like,
S&M type.
Yeah, it's like a leather. Yeah,
leather
yeah.
chaps and, you know, metal chains yeah. and whips and stuff. And I'm sitting on this guy's shoulder, okay, this big, burly Romanian guy, and wrapping my legs around him. And he has to gallop into the shot with me on his back. Okay, but the shot now is being shot because it's a waist up close. You don't see it. But to keep a straight face, to do that shot, to gallop into the point, but the whole crew was crying.
That's acting.
The guy underneath me was hilarious. I was trying to keep a straight face, and then I have to stop and say, the mother load. I mean, that
I need
was,
to rewatch that now, oh my, knowing oh that there's just gosh. Some Romanian man being ridden.
It was hilarious. I mean, it was hilarious.
But what a solution.
What an experience. I mean, this is something you can only experience like when you do movies like that in foreign places, you know?
Absolutely.
And movies, and you know, have bizarre things that happen, but that was really the top of my list.
This Romanian grip probably too is like, yeah, this is how they make movies. That's what happens.
Oh, it was funny. Oh, my gosh. It was so hard keeping a straight face. It was fantastic.
But that movie was pretty big here. Yeah. It aired on cable endlessly and was sort of the precursor to a lot of the stuff that happened in the late 90s, which was a lot of things that you did, the sort of hour-long fantasy series. And we started getting like the Hercules and the Xenas and there was the Stargate and those sorts of shows sort of came in the wake of that, which was a little bit too early. Like, I think if it had been 2 years later, that would have been a TV series.
I agree.
But it was a direct-to-video sort of attempt to make a TV series, and it just was a little too early.
Timing, timing is everything, and I that had a tremendous amount of potential. But you know, it's the way it is.
It's what happens. And George Takei was in it.
George Takei was in it. Yeah.
Had you seen Star Trek before?
Oh yes.
Okay. Did that air in South Africa?
Yes, I believe it did. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So that was that the first sort of TV icon person that you had acted with? I mean, obviously the musicians.
No, actually, acted with. Yeah, I guess maybe acting with, was that my first job? No, my first job, was it with Bill Paxton?
Oh.
Yeah, Monolith. I can't remember the order of which way they came. I don't know anymore, but my first experience with a celebrity here was I was at the Beverly Wilshire Hotel, and I got out of the car, and we were going in, and we walked in, and somebody was holding open the door for me. I didn't even see him, you know, and I just... As I walked by, I just said, "You're welcome," and it was Sean Connery. And I didn't see him. I turned around. I was like, "Oh my gosh, it's Sean Connery!"
Yeah, yeah.
You know, that
very
was
distinctive.
Very distinctive. Yeah. He kind of looked at me like, because I didn't even see him. I just walked right by.
Yeah.
Him.
I'm sure you're taking in a lot of stuff too, going to the Beverly Wilshire Hotel.
Yeah,
because like,
you know, exactly.
You're the last thing you expect to see is
Sean Connery
standing there.
The door for you.
Are you working here now?
Yeah, it's so funny.
So it's very, very. It's a lot, I think, and it's the kind of thing that you sort of retroactively later, if you probably sit down and think about it, you're like, what was going on with that sort
I
of
know.
Thing?
Isn't that wild? It was. If you look and connect the dots later, you're like, geez, it's unbelievable.
What a life that I've gotten to do. And then a bunch of, so you're in VIP with, was Natasha Henstridge in that show? It was like a spy show?
No, VIP, Natasha Henstridge, was Pamela Anderson.
Pamela Anderson, which is the detective agency, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that was, I mean, she was an enormous star coming off Baywatch at that show. And I think she was producing that show too.
She was. Something. I actually did the pilot episode of VIP.
Yeah.
And, you know, then at that point when they came back to do their TV show, I just booked WildWest, and who knows?
Where it could have gone. Yeah. But WildWest, again, is almost like Oblivion as a giant Hollywood movie.
Exactly. Exactly. I love it. I mean, it's just timing, I guess.
Yeah, yeah. You know? But it's an interesting bookend where it's like, you're almost like, yes, this is like you're rehearsing for WildWest and you're kind of like, oh yeah, I've done this before. People are like, hey, if you can't find a horse, I have a solution. If you could find a grip, we might be able to.
Oh my gosh, I know. Since I came here, all the roles I played, everybody always gave me something in my hands, like guns or whips or knives, and I'm always spinning knives, loading guns.
Yeah.
I mean, I pretty much know how to load every single kind of gun. I'm like weapons trained.
Which is probably not how you know. You know, you're like, I'm a ballet dancer.
Yeah, really.
And they're like, give her a gun and a
give
weapon.
Her a gun.
Yeah, but you get these sort of villainous roles, and you know, obviously, you're not.
No.
Like that.
No, I'm not thinking like the characters I play.
Was it weird once you started seeing a pattern where you're like, wow, they kind of see me as this, like, I'm kind of the vampy, you know, evil character.
Yeah, they always saw me as, like,
like tough, deadly.
Yeah.
You know, I was either the somebody chasing somebody or
assassin,
murderer,
bounty
assassin,
hunter.
And,
yeah.
You know, which is, I think it had a lot to do with the like my Betty Page hairdo and the jet black hair.
Yeah.
You know, gave that very foreign look or exotic kind of feel to the character.
So you weren't getting cast as a romantic lead and the girl next door that there's a meet cute at the library, which you could have easily done, I'm sure.
I would have loved to. I would have loved to have done it, but I was up against a few things, which one was the accent and the second one was the way I looked.
Right, right. Which you know? Are two things that one you kind of can't change at all and one is really difficult to change.
Yeah.
But did you kind of embrace that eventually and be like, all right, this is...
Yeah,
this
I did.
This is kind of what I do.
You know, I never, because I was kind of always just, was just going from one thing to the next, to the next, to the next. You know, in the beginning, you try to see if you can adjust it to go in somebody, somewhere else or some other way. But really getting those opportunities, if you have them, you have a very good shot of getting somewhere. But it's getting to get that opportunity when people perceive you in a specific way.
Right.
So it was kind of that toss-up. Do I keep myself in this way and earn my living easily while I'm doing that and just ride that wave? You know, and at that time, sci-fi was kind of looked down upon.
Yeah, it absolutely was.
It was like nobody wanted to do sci-fi. Now it's like huge. Everybody wants it because they realize it's enormous fan base following and loyalty. And
I always, the best example I can think of is if you went to a bookstore then, sci-fi was in the back like it was pornography videos at a video store.
Like it was like below average.
Yeah, like we know it makes money, but we're ashamed that we sell it. Go get it in the back.
Exactly.
Yeah, and it was very niche audience. But you started getting the sci-fi channel started in 95, and it slowly started. And I think the generation of kids from the 60s and 70s who grew up with that stuff were now making things. Yeah. And so it started to really become more mainstream.
Yeah, you know, I think that from looking at all the things I've done, worked on and stuff, when you have scripts that are like sci-fi based, it's not based in any kind of concrete reality. It's actually more difficult to make those B-movies or scripts look good or act well in them than having a beautiful script that's well thought out and clearly defined characters.
Yeah.
That's
easy. Not as much work for you
that's
to do
easy
there.
To do. Yeah. I mean, this, creating this crazy character that has no boundary...
I have no real life experience to draw from to be an S&M whip wielding villainous in a space cowboy movie.
No. So, you know, I mean, it's all the way it's supposed to go.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It seems, and were you watching? I mean, obviously you enjoyed Blade Runner, but were you a fan of that sort of genre before you really started getting embedded in it, or did you kind of grow into it?
No, I wasn't really a particular fan of it. I liked comedies.
Yeah.
I loved dramas. You know, I especially liked foreign films and like all those like Cinema Paradiso, Time Me Up, Time Me Down, My Life as a Dog.
I love Time Me
Up. You know,
Women
the Hairdresser's Husband.
Breakdown. Yes.
Those were the kind of movies. Those are the kind of movies that I really wanted to be in part of.
Right.
You know, that wasn't really available. And, you know, so.
You take the jobs that come to you.
Yeah,
or that
I took what came to me and I embraced it fully because I think that everything is an opportunity to grow from. And,
absolutely.
And I never look a gift horse in the mouth. I'm very thankful for everything I have because you have, you know, it's like, look at how many people there are here.
Oh, yeah. to be, it's like winning the lottery all the time.
It really is.
Yeah. And again.
And I love it.
Yeah.
I mean, I actually do love it. I mean, I do love everything I do.
And again, I some of it is luck, but if you can't deliver, you know, if you get hired to be this crazy role and you can't give them what they need, you're not going to get it again. So it's, you know, you're proving yourself. And I would be remiss if I did not bring up Buffy, as the show comes up often here, and it's a lot of fans on that. And you play, as you alluded to earlier, a human praying mantis, a praying mantis posing as a teacher,
right.
I guess would be the way to say it.
Exactly.
Which I imagine you get recognized from, given the way Buffy fans are, which is an odd thing to get recognized, but that's seemed like a fun.
That
really,
was great.
Yeah,
that was really an amazing opportunity. I'd seen the movie and I'd loved the Buffy movie.
Yeah,
so when I got the job, it was very exciting. And I think it was also part of the very first time they did that whole head turn thing CGI. It's like brand new still, and if you actually see the head turn, you kind of go, we're miles from it today.
Right,
but. I just love the story. I love the whole thing. I love the writing. I love the characters and the people. Yeah, it was wonderful. I always hoped that praying mantis would come back.
Well, you still may. It's still May. You never know. The X-Files have come back. It's, you know, true. You never know.
It's true. But I would love that character to
But
come
that's
back.
Almost like, you know, where you're introducing the videos and you never see them. You're playing a character that's doing some crazy special effects thing that you don't see. And you don't, so right. You see it. You're like, oh, that's, if I had known that's what it looked like, I may have played it slightly differently.
Yeah.
That must be somewhat frustrating, but exciting as well.
Yeah, you know, you just have to go with the flow. It's when you do green screen stuff, you just have to kind of use your imagination
right.
and go, okay, I'll show you a picture. Okay, maybe it's going to look like this.
Yeah, so look at this tennis ball.
Yeah,
this
is a pretend. this
is, here, you know. Is there anything that you watch now or that you're like just addicted to or you're like comfort shows?
You know, I love documentaries.
Okay.
I like it. Yeah, I like educational programs. I like that a lot. And if I watch television, when I do get the chance to watch it, the shows I was addicted to was Breaking Bad, which I loved. I thought it was a fantastic show. Mainly, I go to a lot of film, you know, theaters.
Yeah, and well, you can out here. There's so many.
Yeah, I mean, I'm talking about, you know, movies.
Yeah.
So I, gosh, I like it all. There was a lot of TV shows I watched. I'm trying to think of one that I can. Well, Breaking Bad obviously jumps to mind because recent. And what I recently watched was House of Cards, which I thought was fantastic. Mr. Robot. So many shows.
Do you like the new model of like marathoning these shows and binging them where you can watch them all at once? Because your time is so difficult, you never know when you're gonna.
Yes, I you know, some of the episodes are such cliffhangers. I'm like, I don't want to wait.
I need it right now. Yeah,
I want to see what happens.
You forget how we used to have it, where it's like, no, you have to wait a week, and it was painful to have to sit and wait a whole week sometimes with some of these shows.
Yeah, it reminds me of having to like run home to watch that radio, hear that radio show.
Yeah.
You know,
if I miss the first 5 minutes, I'm not gonna know what's going on. Yeah. So, have you revisited like the Brady Bunch or any of those shows as an adult and rewatched them?
No, that would actually be really funny. I'm going to go find that house.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
That.
It would just the flooding back would be very interesting. It's always fun to sort of revisit these things and see how much they look like you remember them looking is very, very strange.
Yeah.
Documentaries. Yes. Have you seen the one on Canon Films that recently came out?
No.
You'd love it. It has a whole section on the South Africa stuff as well.
Are you serious?
Yeah, it's called Electric Boogaloo,
which
is the name of Breakin' 2, the movie they made. But it's fascinating because it's about the whole rise and fall of Canon Pictures. And it just came out last year, and it's really great. And it's entertaining as well because, I mean, the characters involved with that stuff were so bigger than life. But it's one of the best documentaries I've seen. It's really, really good.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, no, I have to see that. That will be really...
Thinking about as well, there's Richard Stanley, who's a South African director and made Dust Devil and the movie Hardware. And Dust Devil, I think he did in South Africa around that time. A documentary came out this year as well called Lost Souls about the island of Dr. Moreau he made. They're like a great double feature if you're looking for them. They came around the same time, and they're both these like absolutely nutty stories.
I loved them. I would love to watch that.
Yeah, highly recommended.
I'm going to check that out for sure.
Great. Yeah. Well, thank you so much. It was so great to talk to you. I absolutely loved getting to hear your experiences.
Thank you so much for having me, and thank you for the opportunity.
Oh, you're welcome. There you go. As promised, she is absolutely lovely. Could not have enjoyed talking to her any more than I did. Really fascinating life story. Super nice, funny, smart, has a just incredible life story. That's one of my favorite things about doing this show, is sort of capturing people's experiences and their life stories and sharing them with people that you may not have thought to read up on her, or you may not have heard her talk about only seeing the Brady Bunch later in life. And I love being able to get those stories, not on tape, but on, let's say, tape, for people to enjoy and experience. It's a lot of fun. She is great. As I said, I will put up links to all her social media stuff so you can check her out in all the new things she is working on, and definitely go back and check out some of her older work if you have not seen it. Highly recommend Oblivion. There are two parts. Very, very good. Very fun. And if you'd like to contact me, you can email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or at canadicanread.com, icanread.com being my stand-up comedy page, where you can also see if I'm coming to your
your town, or purchase either of my albums, Pilot Season, which is an EP, or The Vanity Project Volume 1, Hollywoodland, which is a full-length album, reasonably priced for you and yours. Great gift for back to school. I don't know if people do back to school gifts anymore. They never actually did, but maybe you should start a tradition. I can't say tradition. Maybe you should start a tradition. Wow, I speak like a mumble-mouthed Boston idiot sometimes, don't I? But it's... Now, I was going to say it's charming. It's not. It's revolting. But what are you going to do about it? Thank you guys so much for listening. And thanks again to Musetta for being on the show. And we'll see you again next time for a brand new episode of TV Guidance Counselor.
When I would laugh so hard in the living room, I would cry. You're white. Apparently, I'm Caucasian. And I'm sitting on this guy's shoulder. Okay, this big, burly Romanian guy in... wrapping my legs around him, and he has to gallop into the shot with me on his back.